Today, we're going to be checking out a pretty cool store, Imperial Reptiles and Exotics, owned by an amazing Alex Estrada. Now, if you guys want to learn more and see some incredible animals, come check it out. Let's roll the intro. What's going on, guys? We're here at Imperial Reptiles and Exotics. Again, I'm Miles, and this here is Alex, and he's the owner of this amazing store.
What's up, guys?
We're going to ask him a couple little questions about all the animals that he has here and what sort of got him into the hobby. Now, the first question I want to ask you, Alex, what sort of sparked your interest for reptiles in the first place?
In general, it was actually a neighbor. I had to have been maybe 7 or 8 years old, and there was a neighbor that had a bunch of different reptiles in his room, and
cool.
He just took me upstairs, showed me his bearded dragon that was like in like a gerbil cage, and
yeah.
He had like a colony of leopard geckos and like a big 40-gallon tank and a corn snake on top of his nightstand. So I remember all this stuff.
Yeah.
And that's really what sparked my interest, just seeing all those animals on there.
Yeah.
And then I bothered my mom for
a
leopard gecko.
People,
just
you know,
bothered her, like,
yeah.
I want a leopard gecko, I want a leopard
yeah.
gecko. And I was terrified of the thing, actually.
Right.
You know, I just like looking at it, feeding it,
yeah.
and it just spiraled out of control
yeah.
from there.
Well, I think a lot of us, when we see those animals and we see them in these, you know, crazy looking enclosures, and then they're doing their thing and they're eating and stuff like that, it really, you know, you just fall in love with it, because it's such a prehistoric looking creature that you don't see, and they're just really cool, you know?
Yeah, and I had a really passion for animals, you know.
Right.
I used to always be going to the library and, you know, getting animal books.
Yeah.
And going to the zoo and just watching any type of animal show on TV, Zabubafoo and all that stuff.
Yeah.
And just being able to actually have like a little piece of the rainforest or the desert
right
there in front of me, I think is what really just like
wrapped
me into it. Man, I had a notebook that I would like take pictures of Reptile Magazine
yeah.
and I'd cut it out and I'd paste it, and then I'd do like a little, like a book report.
Yeah.
You know, I'd do
really
a book
cool.
report on the article, and I think my grandma has it somewhere. I gotta find it.
Yeah, definitely. That would be really cool to see.
That's definitely something to have.
Yeah,
you know? It's around there somewhere.
Right.
Just gotta find it.
Now, talk about your grandma and your family. Were they supportive of this hobby? Because I know a lot of us, when we get into this, and you're like, oh, I want a snake, and you know, parents are like, oh, no way are you getting a snake in that house.
Yeah,
you know?
I think that's typically how it started,
yeah.
especially like with the resistance to like that first leopard gecko.
Right.
You know, we went a couple times to PetSmart, you know. Back then, there wasn't as many reptile specialty stores as there are now. They were
right.
like underground stores, and there were warehouses, and you didn't really know about it. We had the yellow pages,
right.
so you know, I'd go on the yellow
yeah.
pages after
yeah,
I learned
course,
and
yeah.
started going by them. But it was PetSmart, so it took a little time, a couple times going to the PetSmart, them mm-hmm. checking it out, asking the employees questions, until they finally got to it.
Yeah.
There was definitely a no snake policy in
yeah.
the house.
Well, we were talking about it earlier, how Alex has made his store, and you guys will be able to see that when we're going through the pen and everything. It's very inviting. It's very warm. Everyone here is super friendly, and you see all the animals, and all the cages are beautiful. All the cages are clean, you know, and he really strives to do that to just make his store, you know, more enjoyable for people who are coming in and getting their first reptile, which is super important.
Yeah.
That's huge for the hobby, you know.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, we're always talking about, you know, grow the hobby, and that's
absolutely
exactly what, you know, Alex is doing here.
Absolutely.
Now, another question. When you first got your reptiles and everything, and it first started growing into a hobby and then a career and a business, what struggles did you go through, and what would you have done differently if you could go back in time and, you know, rechange something?
That's a really good question, because that's something nobody's actually ever asked me, and
yeah.
that's something that I think about constantly, because I definitely did have my mistakes. I had developed quite a large collection when I was younger. I was probably 18, 19, or 20 when I had a really large collection. And the way it escalated into a business is really unorthodox, because I started as a collector. I had my pets. Then I had too many pets, so they said, you got to get rid of some.
Right.
So I just realized that there was a market to trade and sell reptiles. So I was able to, you know, I'd get some, have them for some time, trade them or sell them for another one, and then that's how I just kept my collection fresh. I kind of got out of it, did other life endeavors. I played paintball for a
yeah.
long time, and I did all that. So that's kind of like where I guess the mistake came. I kind of lost focus, and I kind of went off track, and
right.
I tried to do other things, but life has a funny way of fixing itself. I
yeah.
found myself right back to where I never lost interest. I always kept up with the reptiles,
really,
and I always knew it was something I wanted to do, but I just felt like there was other things in life that I wanted to do before I made such a big commitment to a store, because it's a huge, huge commitment.
Right.
So I was able to do all of that. We talked a little bit about before the interview how I decided I wanted to work small business before I opened up the store.
Right.
and I did all that, and then now we're here, you know, back to my roots, back to what I've always loved, always right. had a passion for, so that's always been there.
Yeah, that's amazing, and you know, you guys will see, when we're going through these animals, he really keeps some really cool animals, and I think that it's really important. We were talking earlier about how you enjoy this more than anything. Like, this is, you know, this is Alex's hobby, and everyone who's watching this video, I'm sure you have some sort of passion for these crazy-looking animals, you know. And it's really important to keep it fresh, you know, so that you're really enjoying it every single day. And, you know, these are live animals, and you stay on top of it. And to stay on top of it, you have to enjoy it.
Absolutely. So, yeah. It's something you gotta stay on track. And some days are a grind. Some days are harder than others.
Of course,
you know,
yeah.
Some days it does feel like a job. You gotta get up, and you gotta clean cages, or you gotta do paperwork, or whatever level in the hobby right. that you're in. Some days it's gonna feel like a job, but at the end of the day, there's always gonna be an animal when you're having one of those days that you're like just grinding to get through, like cage cleaning or tub cleaning, that you just pull out that tub and you find yourself, you know, just looking right. at it or caring at it, and it's like, you know, a normal ball python or a normal fat-tailed gecko, and it's just, you really find beauty in what you like.
I think a lot of people nowadays especially are very caught up with the morphs and everything like that, and I think that it's a lot of people when they get into this hobby, and you know, it's almost like a lifestyle in a way. You get the animals and you look at them, and then there's this $10,000 ball python versus a normal that, you know, $10, you know, for a good deal. And really, when I look at an animal like that, they're just as beautiful as any morph, you know? They really are.
Yeah, and that's how you know we got a real problem.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. Alrighty, guys. Well, we're going to show you the rest of the animals that he has in the store. Again, if you guys have any questions for Alex, you can go check him out. All his info down below is going to be linked in the description. You guys can go check him out. But let's go look at all the rest of the animals that he has and show you guys the rest of his store, alright? Alrighty, guys. Check this out. This is a really cool little snake. Now, this is a T-negative albino blood python. These guys are from Southeast Asia and areas like that. You're not going to find him looking like this in the wild, though. You see, she's getting a little...
Yeah, it's getting a little wonky, but it's okay.
Yeah.
These guys are just very misunderstood animals.
Yeah.
People, they are nippy and very defensive as babies, but as they start growing and get some confidence, they do calm down very well. This guy's just being explorative. If I try to restrain him, he's going to try to turn around. As long as you let him go where he wants to go, he's going to be fine.
Yeah. We're going to throw up a picture of what a normal blood python looks like right up on the screen here. But as you can see, you know, this albino, we've bred these animals to look like this, and she's absolutely crazy looking.
And this will look nothing like what it looks like when it's full grown. When they're full grown, this guy will turn red and white like a Coca-Cola can. Very cool transition to see. Very, very cool. Alright, so this is a Solomon Island monkey tail skink. They also call them the Solomon Island prehensile tail skink. These guys come from the Solomon Islands. They're quite a rare species of lizard. Not a lot of them still available out there. They used to be imported a lot, like super, super common, and then they cut down the import and these guys became a rare species again. This is actually the largest skink species in the world. So these guys will grow over 2 feet when full grown. Their tail is fully prehensile. So as you can see, it wraps around. They have a gnarly bite, so even for this small size, they got a lot of jaw pressure. So they'll bite down. They don't bite and hold usually, they'll bite and let go, but it's still pretty strong. But I think what's worse than the bite with these guys is their nails. That's why we got them on the cork too, just their nails will tear you up every time. And he seems to be more comfortable and easy to display that way. So.
Yeah, so we were talking about how they used to be imported a lot. I was looking at a price list the other day, and you know, you can see these guys for going the same price that you see like a blue tongue going for. Now they're sort of marked them up. They're still really, really cool animals.
Yeah, and believe it or not, this guy's only around 4 months old, so they are very large babies. All right, so these guys are actually herbivores, and you'll see he's kind of like licking. He may just decide to take a quick nip. These guys are herbivores, so they'll eat a bunch of greens and fruits. Here in the store, we feed them collard greens, turnip greens, cucumber, carrots, butternut squash, and the occasional fruit, as well as some of the rapache diet. So super cool species, Solomon Island monkey tail skink.
Alrighty, guys, so check this out right here. This is a Chihuahua gecko, or mossy prehensile tail gecko. Another New Caledonian species, similar to the Cresties and Leechies and all that sort of thing. Now, these guys are a little more on the expensive side, and you don't see them as often, but they're pretty cool little geckos.
Yeah, we like working with them here.
Yeah. Alrighty, guys, so if you look at this right here, this is called a Solomon Island spiny neck monitor, yeah?
Yeah, Varanus spinulosus.
There you go, and this is an absolutely incredible animal. Now, I personally love monitors, Alex loves monitors, and I think it just has a lot to do with their intelligence and their attitudes, of course, as you can see this little spiny neck monitor's got.
He's super awesome. This species of monitor, it's a smaller to medium-sized monitor from the Solomon Islands. So they're actually super beautiful. All these yellows are like highlighter color. They're a very shy and skittish monitor. So as you can see, I was kind of trying to restrain him. He was trying to bite me. I'm kind of allergic to monitor bites, so anytime I get bit by a monitor, my finger or hand or whatever kind of swells a little bit, so that's why I'm a little bit extra careful. But these guys are absolutely super, super, super cool. I love monitors, so anytime I get to work with any type of brand, it's always cool.
Alrighty guys, so if you take a look right here, this is one of Alex's personal pets. No, she's just a normal Brazilian rainbow boa,
Aurora.
Awesome. She's super sweet. A lot of these rainbow boas, when you get them in, you know, they're kind of feisty and everything, but this little baby is absolutely gorgeous and dog tame.
Yeah, we've really picked up an interest with rainbow boas over the past year or so. This is like the first one we got, and we kept her. She's about 10 months old, so we kept her for a while and tried to figure out really how to keep these animals before we jumped full in on them.
Yeah.
But we recently picked up 5 new rainbow boas, so we're really into these guys right now, and we're really excited to be working with them. They have that misconception of being aggressive when they're babies, but they're just kind of scared.
Yeah.
Once you give them a couple meals, they realize you don't mean food, you get a super tame snake like that. We didn't even work that hard to make her tame.
That's awesome.
You know, so she's awesome.
Well, guys, we're going to have some shots coming up here on the screen. You guys can just see those iridescence as soon as you get her in the light. But beautiful little snake. Alrighty, guys, we're just going to pull out some cool colubrids here. You can watch the slideshow. You guys can see all this cool stuff that we got, okay? Alrighty guys, thank you guys for watching this video. I am so happy that you guys enjoyed it. I had so much fun filming it, and Alex over there, if you're watching this video, thank you for having us and inviting us to your store and bringing us into your space and sharing your passion with us. It was absolutely an honor. I enjoyed myself times a million. If you guys want to see more of Alex, again, all his stuff is going to be down in the description. If you want to purchase any of the animals that you see in this video, those will probably be available, so you can go to his website, check that out, and let's support this growing hobby and support the people who are doing so much for it. Now guys, I want to share hashtag grow the hobby, and let's get this started. Let's start expanding this beautiful lifestyle that we have, and everyone on here who has that passion. I want to inspire new people and bring new people onto this channel. Once we reach 200 subscribers, we're going to be doing a giveaway. So guys, stay tuned and stay curious, stay positive, love animals.
I'm going to see if I can hold them.
Lesson plans. So I bring a bunch of different reptiles and stuff like that to my school.
I know, you don't want to
see if we can get them. There's a little shot of Alex wrestling a monkey tail skin. It's a once in a lifetime view.